Rickard Ramhöj från
Can you all hear me? Yes. The slides are online if you want to have a look at them. My presentation today concerns a problematic construction in the Germanic languages, namely relating to subject with passive predicates. I will provide some data from Swedish, which I believe shed some light on this construction. And I will show how the architecture of LFG, with its division of labor, where it is that it will be possible to make some nice generalizations concerning this construction there. So, in Swedish, as well as in several of the other Germanic languages, there is a construction in which the subject of the passive predicate has a thematic role only in relation to an embedded predicate within an infinitival complement. So in one, hon sägs vara en utpräglad målskytt, she is said to be a specialized goal scorer, the subject she has a thematic role only in relation to be a specialized goal scorer and not in relation to the matrix predicate be said. In Swedish, just as in Danish and Norwegian, we have two different passive constructions. A morphological passive using the suffix s, and a periphrastic passive using an auxiliary and a past participle. Here the auxiliary bliva. Interestingly enough, this particular construction, the relating to subject construction, is only possible with the morphological passive and not with the periphrastic passive, which is and that is the same in Danish and Norwegian. The active correspondent to the passive construction seen on the previous slide is the racing to object construction seen here. Folk säger henne vara en utpräglad målskytt. People say her to be a specialized goal scorer. Here the object, henne, corresponds to the subject of the passive construction shown on the previous slide. And of course, one problem about this correspondence is that this active sentence is unacceptable in Swedish, just as it is in English. People say here to be a specialized goal scorer, that's strange. But while in English, relating to object with the predicate say is never possible, but in Swedish, relating to object is possible when you have a reflexive pronoun object, shown in three. So, hon säger sig vara en utpräglad målskytt, or hon säger sig själv vara en utpräglad målskytt, which means something like she considers herself to be a specialized goal scorer. In this case, the relating to object construction is possible. For other predicates, such as anse, consider, raising to object is possible, and it's not restricted to reflexive pronoun objects. So you can say, folk anser henne vara en utpräglad målskytt, and then you have a straightforward passive alternate, hon anses vara en utpräglad målskytt, she is considered to be a specialized goal scorer. And closely related active passive alternation is the alternation between active object control and passive subject control. So you can have a predicate such as tvinga, force. Kommunen tvingade socialsekreteraren att byta jobb. The municipality forced the welfare officer to switch jobs. And you have the passive alternate Socialsekreteraren tvingades byta jobb. The welfare officer was forced to switch jobs. And one common way of distinguishing between these control racing is to try a construction with a non-phonetic subject. So, and in Swedish that would be det. And that is fine with a predicate such as anse, consider. Det anses allmänt att hon är en utpräglad målskytt. It is generally considered or acknowledged that she is a specialist goal scorer, but it doesn't work for the control verb. So, det tvingades att socialsekreteraren bytte jobb. It was forced that the welfare officer switched jobs. That doesn't work. So, there are two, maybe more, questions in relation to the data shown so far. So, why does only the morphological passive occur in the passive racing construction? Or the racing to subject with passive predicates? And what accounts for these restrictions we see on the predicates participating in the racing to object construction? And before I go into these questions, I'd like to mention that this construction, racing to subject with passive predicates, is also possible in several of the other Germanic languages. Here is an example from Danish first, han påstås att vara bortrest. And then we have an example from Dutch, de boten worden geacht over een dag of vier kapon te ronden. Then from English, Melvin was believed to be an addict. Norwegian, patienten kan tänkas vara gravid. And German, in German, this construction does not seem to be possible. So, Obama wird behauptet, die Wahlen zu gewinnen, seems to be bad. An interesting difference between the Swedish version of the construction and the ones in Danish and Norwegian is that the Danish and Norwegian versions, they require a full infinitive complement. So you need the infinitive marker att to be present, while in Swedish, for most predicates, you use the bare infinitive without the infinitive marker. The languages they differ in the extent to which there is an active racing to object alternative to the subject to the racing to subject construction. In English and Swedish, we have racing to object correspondence to most of these passive racing to subject constructions. Norwegian has a more restricted racing to object construction. Danish and Dutch, they seem to have archaic and non-productive racing to object. And finally, standard high German does not seem to have racing to object. But it seems that that all of the languages that have racing to subject with passive predicates today have or have had productive racing to object. So, and these issues have been discussed previously in the literature on several occasions. Especially relevant analysis is the HPSD account given by Bjarne Ørsnes in 2013 for the Danish racing to subject construction with passive predicates. And he doesn't link up the racing to subject construction with an active racing to object construction. Instead, he links it up with with verbs taking finite glossal complements. So here we have a lexical rule which has as its input verbs taking finite glossal complements represented with an S. Then the subject of this construction is a DA, a designated argument, which restricts the thematic roles possible for this subject. It has to be agent or experiencer, but not theme, for instance. And then this verb is then mapped to a passive verb having the S passive form. Remember that they are restricted to S passives, they don't work for the periphrastic passives, and it has a full infinitive complement, and this is a racing to subject verb where the subject of the matrix predicate is structure shared with the subject of the complement. And Elsnes has four principles accounting for the grammaticality of this construction. So first we have passivization, which causes the most prominent argument to be suppressed so that the less prominent argument can be linked to the subject function. Then we have the subject condition, that the verbal predicator has a subject. The racing principle: if a referential subject is not assigned a thematic role by a verb, it must be structure shared with the unexpressed subject of an embedded predicate. And interestingly, he has a so-called participle principle, which is a language-specific constraint, which says that subject-to-subject racing verbs do not form past participles. And this he uses this to account for the fact that only the morphological passive is possible, and not the periphrastic passive, and also why the construction is not possible in German. But this is a language-specific constraint, so it doesn't apply for English, where racing to subject with passive predicates is possible. And in my analysis, I want to remove two of these constraints. I don't want the participle principle, I will not make use of the subject condition, as we will see. So on my analysis, there is a regular active-passive alternation between racing to object and racing to subject, but each of the patterns is associated with a kind of overlay semantics restricting what verbs can appear in the respective construction. So the periphrastic passive is associated with a certain semantics which is incompatible with the racing to subject semantics, and the racing to object construction is associated with a certain semantics which restricted to certain predicates. And in order to investigate racing to subject with passive predicates in Swedish, I made a small corpus investigation using the corpus parole within the corpus collection Corp, made available by the University of Gothenburg. And I searched for verbs ending in an S, immediately followed by verbs ending in an A. And of course that doesn't capture all of the possibilities. Infinitives sometimes end in other things than an A, but it still gives a good idea about the restrictions on this construction. This yielded 4,674 hits, and I found 56 verbs occurring in the subject with an infinitive structure. 16 of these were object control verbs, and 40 racing to object verbs. And out of the racing to object verbs, 15 occur more or less exclusively with reflexive pronoun objects, like say, säga. And here is a list of the racing to object verbs. So we have state, assume, declare, presume, suspect, bet, perceive, admit, foretell, estimate, consider, calculate, assume, point out, suggest, believe, judge, count, experience, For the ones that are restricted to reflexive pronoun objects, we have report, think, await, intend, fear, foretell, presume, expect, say, state, suggest, decide, regard, anticipate, and promise. And I believe there is an interesting difference between these two groups of predicates, at least for the more frequent ones, like say, for instance, or tänka, or think. The predicate say does not express the evidential source for the truth of the proposition of the complement. So when you say something, it doesn't say anything about what the basis is for believing what is said, why that should be true or not. But when you have something like tro, for instance, believe, or beräkna, calculate, there you have some source for the for the proposition expressed in the complement. So for believe, it would be the belief of the sub-subject referent that is the source for the proposition expressed in the complement. And I think this is relevant for the restriction to reflexive pronoun objects. So when you say something about yourself, when you say that you yourself are something or other, then it seems that the evidential source has to be the subject referent, and then raising to object is possible. And we have a couple of verbs where other restrictions hold, but I will not discuss them further right now. And for my analysis, I make use of Anna Kibart's revised lexical mapping theory. And this theory does not include the subject condition, although it has a subject default. So here is a summary of the theory, where you have the familiar cross-classification of argument functions. So based on the features plus minus R and plus minus O, so we have a grouping of grammatical functions where the subject and the object, they alternate with each other. Subject and oblique theta alternate, object and object theta alternate, and oblique theta and object theta alternate. So you have a grouping of argument functions. And then you have the list of A-structured positions in the bottom right-hand corner. So you have with intrinsic features, and this here, and these different argument slots are mapped to grammatical functions based on the mapping principle. The ordered arguments are mapped to the available functions compatible with their intrinsic marking. So an argument with the feature minus R can be mapped to either subject or object. An argument with the feature minus O can be mapped to either subject or oblique theta. And then we have the subject default, which says that the first argument compatible with the subject function is mapped to subject. So when we go through this list, if the first, if you have a verb with R1 and R2, the first argument will map to subject, and then the only compatible function for the second argument is the object function. When we apply this to the predicate say, it could look something like this. So here we have the active racing to object predicate save, and it has two semantic participants which have semantic markers. So the first participant can be mapped, is mapped to, can be mapped to arg1, and the other participant can be mapped to arg4. And then we have this verb, this predicate, also takes another argument slot, which is not associated with any semantic marker. And the arg1 is mapped to subject because of the subject default. Then arg2 is mapped to obj because that is the only compatible function. And then arg4, the only compatible function for arg4 is oblique theta, oblique proposition. And I assume based on, for instance, Zeynen and Engdahl at 94, that oblique theta proposition can be equated to x comp or comp. And the argument structure for the passivized sense, the morphological passive, could look like this. So we have the same participants, and everything is the same except for the fact that we have restricted the first argument by assigning it the plus R feature, which is how you account for passivization. And then arg1 is mapped to oblique theta, oblique agent, and by the subject default, arg2 maps to subject, and arg4 still maps to xcomp. And if we were to think about the lexical entries for these verbs, it could look like this. Here we have the active racing to object predicate sayen, and on the third row we see the racing to object equation. The object of the matrix predicate is the subject of the xcomp, and then we have this restriction to reflexive pronouns shown on the fourth row. And I will talk a bit more about this, if this is really required or if it could be stated somewhere else, maybe. And then we have the lexical entry for the passive racing to subject predicate, says. Here we have a racing to subject equation. So the subject of the matrix predicate is the subject of the xcomp, and the form of the complement is restricted to bare infinitives. Remember that there is this difference between Swedish and on the one hand, and Norwegian and Danish on the other hand, where in Swedish this is restricted to bare infinitives, while in Danish and Norwegian we have full infinitives. And this is one way to account for the restrictions for these two predicates, but it is not fully satisfactory. What is the reason that we have this restriction here, and why do we only have the racing to subject construction with the morphological passes? And I believe this is the result of semantic restrictions for these two patterns. So if we think about the periphrastic bleed passive, and why it is not compatible with the racing to subject construction, several people have written about the restrictions on the periphrastic bleed passive. It is claimed that it is restricted to subjects that are in some way influential or in control of the situation, that it is restricted to animate subjects or subjects where the event is a specific event rather than a generic event. So if we have, for instance, a sign on a door which says that the door opens outward, then the morphological passive is the only alternative. The periphrastic passive is bad because the door is not does not have it doesn't it does, it's not in control. It is not animate. It is not a specific event. So the semantics here is incompatible. And the same thing seems to be the case for the race into subject construction, where you assign a proposition to an unexpressed source, and this seems to be incompatible with the periphrastic passive. And then you have the racing to object construction. Why can you say folk anser henne vara en utpekad målskytt? People consider her to be a specialized goal scorer, but not people say her to be a specialized goal scorer. And that could then be the result of the fact that the subject referent of the racing to object construction is required to express the evidential source for the truth of the proposition expressed in the complement subclause. If I were to summarize what I've said so far, Swedish racing to subject with passive predicates, it alternates with active racing to object, where the object is, for some predicates, is restricted to reflexive pronoun objects. It seems to be incompatible with the semantics of the periphrastic passive. One problem here is how can we represent these semantics restrictions? Where should we represent them? For instance, could you just say something like have a semantic specification, event semantic specification, where the subject referent is both agent and evidential source? What sort of status does evidential source have? Is it similar to how this P source is treated by Asude? In Asud and Koivonen in some of their writings, and I have not made any decisions on that, and I would be grateful for suggestions. And that was everything I had to say. I'm not sure how fast I have been talking.
I just had a small comment about the data concerning Norwegian and Danish, which you mentioned. I think that Norwegian and Danish are just like Swedish when we use your goal scorer example, which had the passive say in the present. But I think that if you take an example with a past passive, things look a little different, because Swedish has the whole paradigm of morphological passives, while Norwegian and Danish don't. So in Norwegian, we actually don't have the past forms of morphological passives. And I took a quick Google search, and you actually do find thousands of was said sentences with racing. When it comes to Danish, I'm not really an expert, but my feeling is that Bredwick morphological passive of say is at least marginal in Danish. And when I took a quick Google search, I found both the morphological and the syntactic passive in the preterite. Yeah, so.
Thanks very much for that comment. That's really interesting because I think that is what should be expected as well. If in Swedish the S passive is the default passive and the periphrastic passive is considerably more restricted than the B passive. In a language like English, the periphrastic passive is the dominant passive, and their racing to object is possible with the periphrastic passive. And Ørsnes, he had this participle constraint, but this seems to be support for the conclusion in which this has to do with the semantic restrictions or the restrictions on the various passive predicates that you have. So in Norwegian, if the S passive is not possible in the past tense in the past tense, for instance, then you would not expect the periphrastic passive to be that restricted. It will be the only passive to be used in the past tense, and in those cases the racing to object construction is possible. But then when you have in the present tense where both passive predicates are possible, then you have some other division of labor between these two passive constructions, where the periphrastic passive is not compatible with the racing to object construction.
Thank you, John.
Hi, thanks. You didn't mention two classes of verbs which are relevant here in English, and I wonder whether they have correspondence in Swedish. First is the want class, which is arguably object raising in English. So you can say things like, I want him quite definitely to be my referee. So the adverb follows the him. But they don't have the corresponding passive. He is wanted to be my referee. That's the first class. And the second class is the repute class, which don't have an active at all, but do occur in passive construction. He is reputed to be a fox hunter.
Mm. Mm. For the want, is that not a control verb?
No, I don't think so.
Because
you say I want there to be.
Yes. Yeah, and yeah, you can't check it in the passive because it doesn't work there.
It doesn't work at all. No. Want does have a passive, yeah. Because you can say he is wanted by the police.
Mm. Yeah, that's interesting.
Mm.
And you have things like rumor as well. Rumored, which is not possible in the active. In Swedish, rumor would be ryktas in the passive, and that does not have an active. You don't have an active correspondent to that. So rykta in the active would be a completely different verb with a different meaning.
Sure, so that's just like English.
Yeah.
Stefan. Yeah, also, hello? Some data remark?
Hello?
Yes.
Okay. Sometimes. So German has the raising to object. You said they don't have it. I think SCI constructions are raising to object, right? And you have things like ich finde ihn doof, I find him stupid. So that's also raising to object in these adjective constructions.
Not as correspondence to these
So I took it as a general remark. And then you have this reformulation or different formulation of the subject constraint. So you say it's a default, and the first argument that is compatible with a subject is mapped to subject, right? So what do you do about impersonal passives? So there are impersonal passives in Danish where you insert an expletive. You have to make sure that there's a subject, right?
Well, you could say that this is a structural thing, that some position, for instance, the spec CP position, needs to be filled in Danish.
And that wouldn't be the grammatical function subject?
You could say that the spec CP position needs to be filled by a subject without requiring there always to be a subject.
Oh.
Maybe. I guess.
But isn't that the same? I mean...
No, because then you would allow for languages that have the subject-less constructions.
But for Danish you would... so this is a general principle, and for Danish you say... You assume Bjarne's principle.
For Danish, one thing to make sure that these have subjects would be to state something like the spec CP position needs to be filled by a subject.
But Bjarne...
That wouldn't... Other things can come in there. But right. That you have some other formulation that requires a subject to be you require a subject to be in the spec IP position, maybe, but that it's a structural thing rather than a part of a general statement that all languages need to have subjects.
Bjarne didn't claim that for all languages, so he was in my project. I wouldn't have allowed that. No, that's not true. You asked Bjarne, he was allowed to do everything he wanted to, but it's wrong for German. So I know that LFG assumes that all languages have, or some versions assume that all languages have subjects, so Judith Behrmann had an analysis claiming that it's somewhere in the morphology, but there are subjectless constructions, so in HPHG it's really not assumed at all. So that was for Danish.
It's not supposed to be universal, this principle. I didn't see that in the paper I read, that whether it was universal or just for Danish.
It's not.
Thank you. I've had a brief look at the two lists of verbs that you give, and they have, I think you have think and believe, but they are on different lists. So you claim that for one of them, I think for the believe, so the source of the belief is given, but for think, it's not. So can you just elaborate on what is the lexical semantic difference between think and believe that you can exploit for this contrast?
For believe, I don't know if I've made correct translations for all of these verbs, but for something like believe, the evidential source would be expressed, like it's the belief of the speaker of the subject reference. But for tänka, I don't think there needs to be a... So you can imagine. I think the translation would be more...
So I can think things that I don't believe, but I can't. So believe is sort of a stronger commitment.
Yes.
Okay. From
yes.
Believer than thinking.
Okay. Thank you. I think
it's just like mental saying.
Yes. Mental saying. Okay. That's a thank good you. Way of describing it.
Okay.
Thank you. This is very interesting. And I have lots of thoughts. I'll just mention four things very briefly. So one is you mentioned, and this is discussed, you know, that it, of course, if there are syntactic constructions which have overlapping functions, and here is actually the underlying syntax, this is passive and this is passive, it is absolutely normal for languages to actually somehow share the functional space using these two different constructions, and so they may have slightly different uses. So this is totally sort of expected, and we shouldn't be surprised to see that there are some either functional or even semantic differences in the uses of two passive constructions. Now, the very interesting question is where to, as you said, where to locate this semantic distinction. My idea would be obviously to locate it somewhere in some kind of semantic component, which has to talk to the argument structure, obviously. But this is for all of us to design this component. It could be perhaps the same component which also requires various other things, like, for example, you know, object marking or not in applicatives, which, you know, depending on the animacy or humanness, and there are various other semantic things in constructions which somehow, which sometimes may restrict the construction or restrict some possibility or allow it. So this is a research project to find out where to locate this. And two other brief comments on the to be reputed and to be rumored and so on. So this is the simplest sort of intuitive explanation for this is that these are resultative participles. They don't have to be passive, and so they don't have to have been transformed, or they don't have to have arisen from the passive. Just like, you know, something that has been that is cracked or even open or broken, that did not have to be broken by someone. Here we have an agent, but also we potentially may add an object agent, which is also fine. The active to passive correspondence can be captured in argument structure, but the verb didn't have to be derived. That verb didn't have to, that participle didn't have to be derived from the passive verb. And the active to passive template is a relation, and if the participle which is expressed through, which is the reputed or rumored, happens to be suitable for an expression such as, you know, he's rumored or he was reputed, then it's fine, it didn't have to arise from an active sentence. I don't see that requirement at all. And impersonal passives with expletives, there is, as Stefan said, no GF subject in impersonal passives, but there is a constituent structure element, yeah, that is a subject like an expletive.
Yeah, thank you for those comments. I think it's a. I would also like to know how to where to represent these restrictions, but and for be rumored and riktas, I'm a little bit unsure. But is an oblique agent possible for these? I can't see. When I think about it in Swedish, it's strange sort of to include a biphrase to include a biphrase. Well, what about English? Be rumored by someone. That sounds odd, doesn't it? And that would support a conclusion that it's not a passive.
Thank you very much.